All right. Hey, good morning. Yeah, you can give it up. That's cool. Good to see everybody here today. Lots of you here. We love to see our church growing. Grateful for that. If you're brand new, reservers, give it up for them. We're so glad that you're here. Please come and say hi. I'll try to keep my distance a little bit because I'm having some of that sickness that's going around. So what I'll do is I'll say hi when I meet you, okay? I'd love to say hi, but I'll try to keep my distance from you. It would be a real privilege of mine. Guys, it's so good to think about what we're doing with Operation Christmas Child. I think last year we did 200 boxes. This year we're doing 300, and we're growing. It's growing, and so we're thankful that we get to be a part of that on December 3rd. So great, great things happening. So what we're going to do today is we're going to start a new series, a three-week series that I've simply called Clearview, where we are and where we believe God is taking us. And if you're a guest, we're so glad you're here because one of our core values is authenticity. And we want you to know what you're walking into, who we are. We want you to know what we love, what we struggle with, obstacles, wins, everything else. We want you to know who we are. And so we're going to talk about our church. We're going to talk about the Lord. We're going to talk about what he wants us to do. We're going to talk about things we're struggling with. We're going to do the whole thing, man. So that's what we're going to do over the next 3 weeks. And so we're glad that you get to join us for this. Reservers, we're just going to talk together over the next 3 weeks. Okay, so thanks for being here. Let me start this way. There's a word that is a very common word that has been around for all of the generations of church and the movement of God. In fact, that's the word, movement. Movement's the word that you hear often in the context of a spiritual trajectory of God, right? It's a movement, right? And movement's not, again, not a new word. We use it in culture. There's a lot of social agendas that use that word, and I'm not going to name them because then I get emails. So I'm not going to name them, but you can fill them in, right? You know, three words, movement, right? Two words, movement and culture and all that kind of stuff. So you know that that's true. And again, it's been around for a long time. I remember when I was speaking at our national conference, our Charis National Conference, I was interviewed beforehand and I was asked the question by the moderator. They said, hey, what are you thirsting for in our fellowship, right? And I just said, I'm thirsting for a movement. And everybody's like, oh, amen, right? Now, I'm super grateful that the moderator didn't ask me, can you articulate what that means? Because I wouldn't have been able to. It just sounded really good, right? When you say I thirst for a movement. Now, I really did. I was being authentic about that. But I'm not sure I was able to articulate what that meant. And as I think about movement, I think about our church, I think movement's a really, really good word. It's a really good word. But what if we tied some concrete, just like a mooring point to it and said, okay, how do we make it like specific? What if we begin to say we thirst for a movement, but what if we begin to say, have you ever experienced a movement moment? A movement moment in your life. Have you ever had that? Do you remember the last time there was a movement moment in your life? Now, how do I define that? I define that as an event that happened in your life that changed the trajectory of your life. You were here going this way. There was a movement moment. And boom, your life went a different way. Now that could be positive, it could be negative in your life. Maybe you, when you were younger, your parents, or maybe even older, your parents split, movement moment in your life. Maybe there was a loss, movement moment in your life, right? Maybe you had a significant graduation, movement moment in your life. Maybe a marriage, some of you were able to experience that. Some, not everybody did, but you did, and that was a movement moment. Maybe a birth of a child, movement moment. Your trajectory, right, was changed. It was changed, right, in a moment. Well, spiritually, those things are true too. Maybe it's the day, and maybe this isn't all of you today, but we pray that maybe we'll have a chance to tell you about them. Maybe it was the day that you realized that God saved you. And when you came to know Jesus, your life had a movement moment. I remember 1982, I had just turned 12 years old. The day before, September 20th, I came to know Christ on September 21st. Please write down September 20th as my birthday. I will accept gifts, cash I like the most. Okay, but the day after my physical birthday, when I turned 12 years old, I came to know Jesus. I walked down the aisle, Judson Baptist Church, West Carrollton, Ohio. Bill Sturgeon, my pastor, led me in his office, shag carpet and everything, led me to the Lord, right? And it was a movement moment. And then I remember in college when I really, really began to follow Jesus, and I was in student leadership, and I had to speak in our chapel, and I stood up to speak, and I came into that chapel with a significant and severe stuttering problem all through high school, and I stood up, and God took it away. He took it away, and I began to speak to people. Movement moment. When was the last movement moment in your life? Can you point to movement moments where the trajectory of your life changed? I remember subsequent spiritual moments in my life, right? I remember being in Orlando, Florida at a conference when God got a hold of my heart and called me to this local body. Movement moment. I remember being at a pastor's conference in California, and the pastor, the leader of this conference, called pastors down if they were willing to a specific movement that they're asking for in their personal lives and in their ministry to come. And I remember, I'm not embellishing this, I remember going down and laying on the concrete floor of that auditorium. It was a little nicer than ours. Okay, we're going to fix that floor. We're fixing it. That's supposed to be funny. Some of you got it, some of you didn't. All right. But I remember laying on that concrete floor, and this, I'm not exaggerating. I was banging it with my fist. And I was begging the Lord, not for a name, not for a size, but just for a movement of God that he would use somehow. Me in our church. Movement moments. Do you have them spiritually? When was the last time you had a movement moment in your life? What if in the next 3 weeks, starting today, this became, as a community, those of us who are part of our community and those of us who are new and will soon be part of our community, what if we looked back in years to come and say, I remember that message. I remember the conversation in that life group. I remember that conversation after church with someone. I remember someone praying over me. I remember when God changed my spirit, when God changed my attitude, when God lit me on fire for his kingdom, when God called me to do what only God could do, when God saved my marriage, when God called me back to my children. What if in the next 3 weeks there were movement moments that happened for you? And what if you began to pray that way? And what if that movement moment began for us as a community in a church? What if? You just think about that. And so again, if you're a guest, we're just glad you're here. And you're going to get an authentic look at us. And so what's our rhythm as a church? Our rhythm as a church is that two or three times a year, we hit what I call the pause button. We talk about our mission, our values, where we were, where we are, and where we're going. And that's what we're going to do in this series. And today we're actually going to talk about that, all three of those things, where we were, where we are, and where we're going. And over the next 3 weeks, you're going to hear more about where we're going and what we're doing to fulfill the mission and vision that God has given us. Now, you remember, I say two or three times a year, we did this back in the spring. We had reserve nights, and most of our people showed up, and you came to those things. They were smaller settings, and I shared with you where we were, where culture was, what we needed to do in the coming years to be effective for our 15 years that we have in this generation before we turn it over to all of you others, okay? And with the help of Doug Justice today, what we're going to do is we're going to share with you the first part of three, covering where we are, where we believe God is taking us. We want to get a clear view. Okay? Get it? Good. All right. Grab your Bibles. It's going to be up on the screen, but grab, I'm going to frame it biblically, what we're talking about. Turn to Matthew 28. I tell you, it's on the screen, but I'm saying this every week. Bring your Bibles, mark it up, write notes. If God speaks to you, write down what God is saying to you. Write down the meanings of passages so you can go back and understand them later in your personal time with the Lord, okay? Matthew 28, 18 through 20 is what we're going to look at. And I'm just going to talk about it just for a couple minutes, and then I'm going to share with you kind of where we've been and so forth, okay? Matthew 28, 18 through 20, the Great Commission says this. Then Jesus came to them and said, "All authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Therefore, go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything I have commanded you. And surely I am with you always to the very end of the age." Father, I pray right now that as we understand your word, we consider your word and consider our church as a result of your commission to us, that we would be motivated by your spirit to do whatever it takes to fulfill this commission in our lifetime. That's what we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. So what's happening here? Jesus is about to ascend into heaven, and he gives this great commission. And we need to understand what he's saying. There's been some different interpretations and teaching of that. Let me just make it very clear and very simple. Grammatically, the main verb that we see here is make disciples. That's the main verb. So every believer, every church since this time has been commissioned by Jesus through a command to make disciples. That's who we are, what we do, and what we're called to. That's the verb. And then there's participles around it that complement the verb. Go is could also be translated going. It's present progressive as you're going. It's not just for missionaries across the world. It's for us in our workplaces today, and baptizing and teaching people so that they might become wholehearted followers of Christ. Those complement the main verb. That's the way that we continue to carry those things out. All right. And so we, as a church, a local church, receive this calling. And by the way, every evangelical Bible-teaching church, if you go to their churches, this is the mission, right? So you can go to different, ways that they do ministry, different emphasis, different, you know, missionary-type things, different, you know, ways that they disciple, ways they do worship. You can do all different styles. But if they really hold to the Word of God, this is our mission. And it's common, and it's across the board, and it's what we are called to. Now, making disciples, though, and we see this very clearly, is a complex and unique calling to each local church. And we need to understand that for ourselves. That's why we should never, 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 never compare churches. That's why that, you know, as I talk to pastors, and I'm nobody, but as I talk to them, and usually pastors are like, "Well, how many do you have in your church?" I don't care how many you have in your church. Right? It's what are you doing to make disciples? Okay? And that's what we are called to do. And it's complex, and it's unique, and it's for each church with the same mission. It takes precision. It takes understanding. It takes training. And we have to understand culture that we are the culture that we're situated in, know how to interact with them for the sake of the gospel. Paul taught us that. Paul said in 1 Corinthians 9, who planted a bunch of churches, who pastored young pastors, and helped them see the overall purpose of the gospel was for all people. And he said, listen, to the weak I become weak, to win the weak I become all things to all people, so that by all possible means I might save some. Now listen, that is not right? That's not doing everything short of sin to reach people. I've heard people say that. No, it's understanding where you sit and then how we express the gospel clearly and effectively. I do all of this for the sake of the gospel that I may share in its blessings. It's for the gospel, understanding where people are and helping them. Over in Acts chapter 17, right? Paul is never sacrificing truth, never watering anything down. We never water anything down. It's the truth. In Acts 17, Luke records Paul reasoning three different times with three different groups of people, helping them understand what the gospel has to do with their lives and understanding it is a movement moment if they will just trust the Lord, right? They were debating historical religious practices, all kinds of things, and Paul reasoned with them. And that is why every evangelical church is called to and should focus on, right, the gospel and understand in its context how we are then to handle and develop ourselves in our community, right? Get it? Good. Understand that, okay? It's so, so important. So every local church, evangelical church, is called to do this, and that's our focus. But every local church has a unique story. Every local church has unique obstacles and challenges. I was talking with Doug this morning, and we were talking about an obstacle that he's going to talk with us about. And I said, listen, I'm thankful for the obstacle. Because every church that follows Jesus has obstacles. Every church that doesn't follow Jesus doesn't have obstacles, right? Real obstacles. They just kind of, okay, you get it. Anyway, right? We're a faith community. We have unique challenges, right? And we have a unique strategy, right? So because of our unique story and our unique challenges, I remember 2 years ago, or excuse me, 3 years ago, I started talking about coming out of the pandemic, I remember talking about rebuilding our church as every other church in the world was doing. A couple months later, I realized I'm not called to lead everyone to rebuild the church. I'm actually called to replant, relaunch this one. Crazy. And so we, under the radar, relaunched the church. I remember sitting with my team and I said to them, I said, guys, you just need to know we're a church plant. Doesn't look like we're a church plant. There's a lot of people, but we're a church plant. We have to start over, and we have job descriptions, but here's your job description. We do everything. We figure it out together, and we equip people, and we work it out together. So we started on that journey. I told you guys that as well. And let me tell you something. I've had a blast. I've had more fun in the past couple years than I've had in the past 20. And that's no exaggeration, okay? Some of you are like, well, it's because you had a sabbatical this year. No, it's not the only reason. I didn't think that'd be that funny. I'm going to throw that out there. Okay, we've had a blast. But I'll tell you something. I've never worked harder in my life, even with a sabbatical, okay? My team has never worked harder. Volunteers have never worked harder. We've never had to own something together like we've owned this together. It has been a challenge. It's been huge. In my years, okay, 27 years, I've never seen larger challenges for the corporate church and for ours, and we've had them. I've never seen larger challenges, and I'm being authentic about that. Obstacles are real. As an organization, we now exist in a culture that is more expensive to live in. I've read two different reports. Okay, one gave an annual cost of living increase, one gave a monthly cost of living increase, and they're within $100. It is now costing the average American family $7,300 more per year to live. Just over $600 a month to live. That's what it's costing you compared to last year, 2022. That's significant. So you can kind of guess what our obstacle is. Because what happens then is that the places that we have disposable income, if you will, if I can call it that, I don't mean it that way, that's what begins to change. Okay? The church is no longer the center of the community. When I got in ministry, it was. So a church sits in a community like ours of about 8,000 to 10,000 people, and you're the center of it. Now, we have a bunch of churches here, but it's no longer the center of the community. The church is no longer trusted in culture. Can I just be straight with you? Because of some boneheaded leaders. Blue trust. Okay? I can say that because I'm a leader. All right? The church, which used to be the moral code of culture, has now been replaced with social movements. Because we're not trusted. To the culture, we are no longer the mooring point for right and wrong. It's now left to the individual. Okay? Churches nationwide are barely surviving. 20%, one in five churches have closed in the past 3 years. Only 16% of pastors in North America are under the age of 40. Now think about that. 16% of pastors are under the age of 40. Okay? 16%. 65% of pastors in North America will be 65 or older in the next 6 years. 65%. I shared with those statistics back in the spring. So that's why we need to take care of Pastor Lawrence. He deserves that $150 a year that we give him. No, I'm happy to give him 30. Okay. But we don't have a well to come from. Now, the church corporately seems to be in crisis. Okay. But is it? Is it really? Are we defined by our obstacles and our struggles, or are we defined by the one who's the head of the church? Louis Giglio was interviewed by Carrie Newworth on a recent podcast. And Louis was asked, he said, it seems that spiritual forces of darkness has an incredible grip on culture. Could you, and it's now, and it's affecting the church. What do you think about that? You know what his quote was? I love this. He's an older guy now. A lot of you don't know who he is. Some of you do. But his quote was, what I have found in the generations that I've been alive through is that in every generation, the devil overplays his hand. He thinks he's going to win, but the church always survives. And the church thrives. His response was, I see a greater hunger for spiritual movement in the lives of people than he's ever seen in his decades of ministry. I believe that. Look at Asbury. Look at the church, look at the college campuses around that where spiritual revival kicked up, longing for the movement of God. Have you read about Greg Lowry in California? They had a baptism service that lasted 6 hours in the ocean. For 6 hours, protesters came to try to stop them. Law enforcement had to stop the protesters from like engaging them in a negative way. And they just kept baptizing people. 6 hours in the ocean. Incredible. Incredible. There's a spiritual hunger. It's unbelievable to me as I read reports like that. Then I hear, personally I hear, and then I read articles where the church and pastors and people are taking shots at that kind of stuff. And they mute it. Listen, I don't care if you disagree with some of the theology, but if God is moving, celebrate the movement of God. Because I'll tell you something. I would love to baptize people for 6 hours here. Take all the pot shots you want. So is the church in trouble? I don't know. Culture would say, yeah. I would say, nope. I believe it. What Louis said, I think he's right. So 2 years ago, we threw out the church subculture playbook. 3 years ago, sorry. I kept writing two in my notes. So that's why I'm saying that's three. And I said, God, what do you want us to do? And so we, as a leadership team and others, we coined our phrase officially, get it, got it, give it away. And that's our phrase. It's our mantra, right? It's what I've said it for years. Get it, good, right? And so we took good, said give it away. It's knowing Christ, reflecting Christ, of course, and then giving it away to people. Let me talk to you about get it just for a minute, just so you understand what we're talking about. It's the foundation of training people to know Jesus and his word. As I've said, culture has changed. That's expected. But listen to me, friends. We have the foundation of the hope of the gospel, and we stand firm on the word of truth that he's given us. That's what we will always, always, always stand on, and we will work it through, even when culture doesn't like it. May we as a church never, ever get over Jesus. May we never grow callous to his standard. May we, through faith, learn to trust him and what he says. Because it's going to be challenged, it's going to be dismissed, it's going to be dubbed irrelevant, and we are going to be seen as haters of culture. And let me tell you something. I'm okay with people taking shots at us for the things that we believe and we hold to. What I'm not okay with, right? What I'm not okay is that that we create a culture that hates the kingdom of the world. I'm not okay with that. I'm not okay with making blanket statements about culture and they're this and they're that. Right? I'm not okay with that. We're called to engage culture. We are part of the kingdom of heaven, and we operate as a community, and we train, and we know the word of God, and we are different, and we hold to truth, even when we're misunderstood. I'm okay with that, but don't go out and judge and criticize and create a culture of cynicism. We have the hope of the gospel, the hope of Jesus, and if you go out and do that, the only thing I ask is that you don't tell them that you come here. That's all I ask. Because I don't want that culture here. I look forward to the emails on that, okay? Aren't you glad you came to church today? Yes. All right. So what we did to develop the disciples that know the word of God is we hired Emily and Lawrence LaFollette. They weren't LaFollette yet, but they are now. They have a baby to prove it. But Emily replanted our youth ministry. That went from five people to 40 plus. Unbelievable, unbelievable. We hired Lawrence to do this, to be the get it guy. Or you can start calling him that. I'm the get it guy, all right? But he's provided the foundation of Jesus and his word. We now have core training. We've seen 47 people walk through 12 weeks of core training. And it's our doctrine. It's what we are. He writes our life group material based upon my messages. He wrote a devotional covering the primary doctrines that are covered in core training. So if you come to our church now and you come to stakeholders that I teach, you get a copy of that devotional and we ask you to go through it so you know our basis, and then we're going to grow on top of that, and Lawrence is going to share that with you. Okay, so get it is all about training people to know Jesus and his word. Get it? Good. We also want to be got it people. All right, teaching them to obey everything that I have commanded you. Okay, so it's understanding the commands of Jesus and learning to live our lives through the lens of Jesus. We want to be got it people. People need to be biblically discipled in marriage, biblically discipled in finances, biblically discipled in relationships, biblically discipled in workplace environments. In the coming weeks, again, Pastor L. Lawrence will talk about that, okay? All right. Additionally, in order to be effective, God at people, we need to understand the culture that we live in. We need a clear view. We know that Jesus, as we study his life, he shared truth, but he shared his life. Relationships was the currency of Jesus. He sought to understand them, as we saw that Paul did as well. And guys, let me say something to you, okay? The secret sauce to this church being healthy is not the next big thing. Let me say it again. The secret sauce to this church being healthy is not the next big thing. It is understanding the culture in which we live, being relational as we uphold the word of God and make disciples. That's going to be our format, already is. Now, We need to understand our culture. I shared this back in the spring, okay? And we'll invite Doug to come up in just a minute because we got to get him up here. What I shared with you back in spring and reserve nights, if you were there, I actually had three circles. I had a whiteboard, and I made so many notes on it, it looked like some kind of rat's nest, because me, I always just write things out. My staff knows that. But I just put two of them up here. I shared this again back in May, even up here on the screen. And what we have here is we have two cultures that we're trying to understand. One is the Christian culture. One is the post-Christian culture. The Christian culture is not what we live in any longer. We now live in a post-Christian culture. Let me explain. The Christian culture was known back in the day for objective truth. They were known for programs and events. Somewhere around the late 70s, early 80s, it began to shift into a post-Christian culture. Now, the millennials get a lot of blame for this, but they're not to blame, right? They just kind of grew up in it, and they always point to millennials, but it actually started before the millennials came into leadership in the church and the culture, okay? So now, let me tell you about Christian culture. Objective truth. There was a reality back in the day during the Christian culture time there was just this standard of truth. Always exceptions to it, we know that. But overall, there was the assumption that there was objective truth out there, and it was related to God and the Bible, right? And even if people disagreed with it or rejected it, the truth was they knew deep down, because it was assumed, that there was objective truth that was out there. That is why Billy Graham could have a big crusade, 50,000 people come to a stadium, 10,000 people come down and receive Christ as their Savior. Why? Because there was an objective truth. People came and they knew that they needed to respond to that objective truth. It was successful. It was huge, right, back in the day. And because of that assumed objective truth then, we could have programs that we trained people in with the assumption that there was objective truth. We could have events, the crusades, right, that people accepted overall. Why? Because we were in what historians call a Christian culture overall. We shifted. Okay. Oh, and by the way, I'm going to say something about this. One of the things about Billy Graham, he was so successful, we didn't need to know Billy Graham personally. And the reason we didn't need to know Billy Graham personally was because he was trusted, okay? He was trusted and people responded to him, right? Now you move into the post-Christian culture, has a fly on it, all right? We get there. That's known as subjective truth, and relationship and trust are the key currencies, right? In other words, my truth is my truth. Your truth is your truth. It's not that I don't want you to share your truth, but you just need to know that you can't blow up mine. It's my truth. Right? That's the overall belief. It's my truth. The key thing here is to understand this. Again, this was a two-hour conversation, okay, back in the spring. Relationship is the currency. Back here, programs were. But now relationship is. I will not just respond to you because you say I should. You need to know me. Right? It needs to be a relationship, and you need to have my trust. Right? And that's the culture that we live in. Get it? Good. All right. And because of that relationship and trust, this group wants to own it. And so what we said back in the spring was, we're going to make clicks to make sure we as a church are doing that. People want to interact. So we had this series that Pastor Lawrence did. I was amazed at Pastor Lawrence. I watched, while I was on sabbatical, okay? I watched him do that. And for 12 weeks, or 9 weeks, whatever it was, he let you interact with him, right, on some of the hardest truths in all of Scripture. Phenomenal. Circle three. That's why we did it, okay? We also are doing my story videos, okay? My story videos are us getting to know one another, to be in relationship. You're sharing your story. We're not trying to close the loop in a three-minute video. We're sharing the story. Why? Circle three. Get it? Good, okay, so what we're doing, that's got it, right? And we're going to continue to do that. We're going to keep moving, and Pastor Lawrence is going to share some of the things we're going to do around that, as I have said, all right? Now, give it away is where we're going to go to. I'm going to cover that in a few minutes. If we can get there, we'll see. We have some large vision to share with you, big plans for the future, But before we can do that, we got to talk about our obstacle. Okay, every church has them, and we certainly have them as well. We are not a perfect church, okay? So we need to identify those and then have a plan to overcome so we might be free to live this calling and give it away. All right? So let's bring Doug Justice out. Let's bring Doug Justice out. There we go. All right, Doug. Hey, man.
Bring the obstacle out, right? Is
that, you know? What's that?
Bring the obstacle out.
Yeah.
I think that's how I heard that.
I keep tripping. Oh, it's just Doug. Okay.
You know, I got to tell you, I'm still processing 6 hours in the ocean.
Right?
There are sharks in the ocean.
Yeah, I mean, they get hungry in those 6 hours.
Yeah. I'll take our little hot tub thing for 6 hours. We can do that for 12 hours.
That's great. That's great. Yeah. We'd have to change the water, though, I'll be honest with you.
That's gross, and you're right. Okay. But yeah.
Yeah. I'm not getting baptized in that.
Film.
Yeah. I'm first.
Yeah. Okay. So with that visual.
Yeah. Hey, man, Doug oversees our finances here, and our obstacle that we're having moving forward are our finances. He's going to share just where we are and then what we're asking God to do. So
yeah, it really is just a family moment, right? Where we can talk about where we are, but not get mired down in where we are. Keep that in mind because we've been here before and we'll talk about that as part of this too. So where are we? As of the end of October, so week and a half ago or whatever, we've been averaging about 25% less in giving over the course of the year, for month to month. You know, Jason teed this up before, expenses are up. They are for all of us, right? Things are different, and they are for us as well, and our giving has been down. So there's been a gap that's developed over the year.
Well, and we shared that back. We just saw that back in the first quarter.
We talked about it then. Yeah, we were already seeing it. Yeah, it's been consistent. So that's where we are, but it's not where we're going to stay. I think it's important to recognize that. We want to call it out and talk through it in terms of what we're doing about it and what we're praying about for God to do as well. Couple of things. So we've taken steps to reduce expenses short term now and even leading into next year's budget. We've made some cuts that way where we can to bring things more in line. We know we have to do that. And we also have some income coming in through some insurance payments that we're gonna use to get rid of the lovely floor that we have right now. That, like Jason said, is going to change. At the end of the day, we think we're going to end this year about $140,000 behind budget. Now I say that and everybody the air kind of goes out of the room, right? But with that, with those insurance payments and some of the cuts we made, we think we'll be able to cut that about in half. So we'd have about 70 to 80,000 shortfall at the end of the year. And that's where we're at.
Yeah.
Now, I will tell you, and Jason may reiterate this, we've been here. We were here last year at right about the same spot, at about 70,000 behind for the year. And God answered that through you. We finished the year in the black. Praise
God.
And
we have the past 3 years.
We have the past 3 years.
This year just was wild. Yeah.
Yeah. This one came at us a little differently.
Yeah, sure did.
So the number itself is big, but we've been here and we've seen God work. So that's where we are, where we're going then, and Jason's going to talk a lot more about this, but we want to challenge all of us to think about year-end giving, a special gift. We do have some reserves. We've been blessed with some reserves this year and savings. We had hoped to keep those in savings and use them to grow things in other places, but we also have that. The message here, guys, is we're not going down. We're gonna make it, but we need to rally together on this. We're asking you to think about a year-end gift of some kind, some special giving towards year end. We have Last count, we have about 122 giving units, regular giving units. So if you take that 80,000, divide it by 122, that takes you to $715 per giving unit. Now, I'm just throwing that out there. For some of you, that's insurmountable. For others, that's, you might be able to do more than that. I'm just giving you that as a figure to break it down a little bit in terms of bite-sized pieces. My ask is that just pray about it. Just see where God leads you on it. This to me is something, yet again, that becomes a movement moment for us. It's something that when you do something that feels a little maybe counterintuitive, you know, I don't feel like I have this to give, but you take the step of faith, and then you see what happens from that. I can tell you that Deb and I have done that over the years, and it's just like on paper, it makes no sense. It doesn't make sense to do this. But God's always provided for us. That's where we are. It's a quick look at where we're going into next year. Jason's going to talk more about the vision for next year and really kind of where this sets up.
Yeah. Okay. Let's hear it for Doug. Thank you, brother. Appreciate it.
Feel free to reach out to me, too, if you want to ask questions or anything. Happy to talk about it. Thanks, guys.
So we really set this up so that I could share good news and he could share all the bad. That was really what we... No, it really, we're fine, but we want to make sure that we tell you where we are and what we need to do. Doug is so gracious in saying pray about, you know, giving big at the end of the year. I'm just going to tell you to do it. You just need to get big. Let's do that. I'm praying that we'd hit $100,000. That'd be awesome, wouldn't it? And you'll see why it'd be great. So this is where we were last year. We know that God will overcome it. We've hit budget, but we want to make sure we're communicating. And again, we knew this in first, I told you this back in reserve nights. Hey, this is a weird year for some reason. We've been doing so well and everything, economies change, all these things. We know that that's reality. So because of this reality of knowing that things are more expensive and all that stuff that we're talking about, giving has been affected. We're not having people leave our church. There's nothing wrong. It's just, it's been effective. I've had several families come to me and say, listen, what am I supposed to do? This income's been lost. I've, you know, several that have said that to me, and working through how to give to the Lord. Okay, so I know it's very real. All right, so what do we do to address this obstacle and invite the Lord to do His work? All right, I'm going to try to move this through this very quickly, and we'll keep unpacking it in the coming weeks. Okay, so I'm just about out of time. Number one to me, you need to know from my heart to yours, it's not just about increasing revenue. It also has to be on mission. Okay, so we have to, that's what I was praying about, because I don't want us to lose the clarity and centrality of the gospel. Okay, so our vision when we built this facility was to build a building for the community that we get to use. And so we began to ask the question around these things, how do we get more people into our building, share our faith, and still create revenue? That's kind of how it was. That's kind of, like, how do we do that? Okay. Well, Doug already said this, but there's some points up on the screen. Number one, we decrease expenses and increase revenue. There's a really good idea. Let's do that. Okay. So he talked about that already. We're making sustainable budget cuts. And they're significant cuts, but they're sustainable. We're not robbing our ministries and so forth. They're sustainable. We also need major or significant revenue increase. So let me tell you about what we have come to and what's already been working in the background. It's so funny. It was actually Brian and Sarah McMahon that came up with this idea. So when it works and God blesses it, we'll put a picture of them up in the church, okay? We're going to begin an after-school program here in our church. We're going to do that very quickly. There are no faith-based programs in our area. I asked Brent Runkle and Doug Justice. Where's Brent? Brent's here somewhere. There he is, right in the middle, right there. Doug, or Brent and Doug rather, did research on the viability, first of all, and the ability to begin a program. They found it very viable. I met with Brent this week to make sure I didn't say anything wrong. They found it to be very viable. We have minor adjustments to make in our building, but we can begin it very quickly, right? We've done research on what income could come from that potentially, and the need in the community, and both are very, very positive, okay? They're already developing right now a business plan for that, and we're actually talking to someone else in our church that is in the business world to join Brent and Doug to move from an investigation team to actually an implementation or development team for this. That's going to happen. We're praying even in the first quarter of next year. Not only are we looking to do an after-school program, but we're also very deeply planning on and working through the idea of a daycare here at our church. Brent actually helped me see some of the, I didn't know this, this is amazing. So he equipped me and found out that COVID relief for daycares that was given through the pandemic were good for all the way through September of this year, September 30th of this year. It's an estimated that 70,000 daycares are going to be closing by the end of the year. 3.2 million children will lose care due to the lack of space. They don't have facilities. They can't afford to rent facilities. They can't do that. And the help from COVID relief was funding them. So we sit at another great opportunity. Now, there's much to do around that. We understand that. But we actually have the building. It sits here. We have a beautiful children's center. We have a, as soon as the floor gets put in, beautiful gym that we can use. And it's just a beautiful building. And it's set up that way. So we are moving forward with that for investigation and then eventually development of that. We don't have time frames on that yet, but in the next couple weeks, no, I'm kidding. In the next year or two, we'll hopefully have the ability to tell you when we can launch that, all right? You will be brought in on everything around that. The final thing that we're doing is tomorrow morning at 10 a.m., we are meeting with two consultants to begin an advisory relationship in creating and carrying out a financial campaign in 2024. And we're going to meet with this team of men, and they're going to help us understand how to do it and do it well. We'll be carrying that out, and we'll communicate to you. The main vision we believe of this is going to be the daycare. It's going to be our building, what needs to happen to it. We need to put in a nice playground. We need to put in all kinds of, like, you know, an industrial kitchen, things like that. I actually have this idea. Elders don't even know this yet, but I'd love to put an indoor play area downstairs and somehow that people can rent and use and be a part of, but they may tell me I can't. But we'll talk about it. Okay, but we're talking about the vision of that to fund it and also to fund the church, okay? Get it? Good, all right. So how do we get there? I'm going to quit. How do we get there? Well, first of all, Doug talked about it. Is a year-end offering. Doug outlined a need that we had last year, we have this year, which is amazing. That's where we're at, to be honest with you. It's amazing that's where we're at because our expenses went way up and our giving went down because of the same equation there. Okay, so I understand. I want you to know something too. I've alluded to it, but I mean this. I know that you've been affected financially. I know that. And so some of you have had to pull back, and you've talked to me. I respect you for that, okay? I'm asking you to continue to evaluate it, talk to a pastor, talk to an elder, and think about that reality and how God might help you reorganize some things to help. So the year-end offering, $70,000 need-ish, something like that, right? I'm asking the Lord for $100,000, okay? This extra 30, we'd be at budget, we'd make it, and then the extra 30 could be used for some wiggle room to maybe do invest in upfront needed improvements and stuff for the after school program, all right? We actually need to move on some of that, and we don't want to take savings unless we have to. So if we could hit 100,000, I will give you a big old fat thank you. Nothing else. Okay? That's what I'll do. Only the Lord can do it. All right? And then increase giving. We're going to ask you to keep giving more. Okay? We're not going to shy away from that. I was in some meetings this week. I have the privilege to serve on a national board of directors for a ministry. We went over their finances. I talked to other pastors and their finances. This is the obstacle, guys. It's across the board. And what I am learning and realizing, okay, and some of you are business people, you think like this, we have to have other streams of income because the world is changing. So we need to figure out how to fund things in different ways. The organization I serve on, 70% of their income are from different programs and things they offer, not giving. Only 30% from giving. Now, I don't ever want to do that. Okay, meaning 70-30, but I know we can increase some revenue. Okay, I talk to pastors. There's people that are $600,000-$800,000 behind coming into the year. It's crazy. That's why churches are closing at 20% rate. All right? So we're good. We're fine right now. But in 3 years, if we don't do some things and we're making some changes, then things could change pretty drastically. And I'll take your order at Chick-fil-A then. Okay? If God calls me to do that, it's fine. I don't care. Make sense? Get it? Good. I truly love you. And I know what we're doing as a church, God's using, and we're going to keep moving together. And so hopefully you're excited and encouraged. I am. All right. Let's pray. I'm late. Jesus, thank you for this time. Thank you for your church, your word, the vision that you've given us. Help us to be very, very strategic, humble, and full of faith as we follow you. I pray your blessing upon this movement of after-school program and eventually a daycare. God, if you want that to happen, open all the doors. If you want to stop it, Lord, fine, just stop it. We just want to be under your direction so that we can create the environments for people that will soon be your people to come, understand your truth, and follow you. So that's our prayer, Lord. We just need you to work. We love you. I pray you would pour, in the name of Jesus, I pray that you would pour buckets and buckets and buckets and buckets and buckets of resources upon this place. We want to bless the community. We want to bless people who need it, Lord, and we want to do things in such a way that would just create a movement moments for people, God. Thank you for this clear view today. We love you in Jesus' name. Amen.